Well, it's a real privilege to be here, and before I begin, I always like to read out of Jeremiah chapter 18. If you're a potter, you almost have to read that passage. It says, "The word which came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, arise and go down to the potter's house, and there I will cause you to hear my words. Then I went down to the potter's house, and there he was making something at the wheel. And the vessel that he made of clay was marred in the hand of the potter, so he made it again into another vessel as it seemed good to the potter to make." Now, I've been privileged to do this presentation many times and literally around the world. And it wasn't until a month ago, I read this passage when I do it, and a month ago I was at Calvary Chapel in Murrieta, and I was reading it, and suddenly verse 2 like really sunk in. Here's what it says. He says, go down and I will cause you to hear my words. You see, Jeremiah was going to go observe the potter, but God was going to speak to his heart. He said, you're going to hear my word. And that's my prayer tonight, that as I do this, that you would hear the word of the Lord, that you wouldn't just see pots being made and just observe that, but you would hear the word of the Lord, because that's what happened to Jeremiah. Now, for your information, the art of making pottery has not changed since the time of Jeremiah. For thousands of years, people who make pots have made it the same way. The only difference is I'm using an electric wheel. Jeremiah would have had a big stone wheel and had someone turning it, and I couldn't get anybody to turn a wheel, so I brought an electric one. But that's the only difference. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to start out just by making a pot, and I want you just to observe. I think it's interesting. It's amazing what people tell me they learn just from watching me make a pot. And then we'll get into the teaching aspect. So I've asked Jeff to come, and he's just going to sing a song while I make a pot, and hopefully I'll get one made. You know, it's always scary getting that first pot made, and I found out with some of the worship teams, some of them have some experience, so if I need help, I'll call on one of them, you know, to get this done. But I'm just going to try and make a pot, and just watch and observe and see what the Lord would speak to you, and then we'll get into a time of teaching.
Wonderful Savior, I know for sure that all of my days are held in your hand, crafted into your perfect plan. You gently call me into your presence, guiding me by your Holy Spirit. Teach me, dear Lord, to live all of my life through your eyes. And I'm captured by your holy calling. Set me apart, I know you're drawing me to yourself. Lead me, Lord, I pray. Take me, mold me, use me. Guide me, lead me, and walk beside me. I give my life to the potter's hand. Beautiful Lord, days are held in your hand and crafted into your perfect plan. You gently call me into your presence, guiding me by your Holy Spirit. Teach me, dear Lord, to live all of my life through your eyes. And I'm captured by your holy calling. Set me apart. I know you're drawing me to yourself. Lead me, Lord, I pray. Take me, mold me, use me.
Right, we got one made, huh? That's always good when you get the first one done. Now, hopefully you were watching and you noticed that I used a lot of water as I was making that pot. And, you know, I think that's very relative to the fact that God says his word is like water to our souls. And you see, without water, we become dry and hard, and God can't work in our lives. And the same with the potter. The potter can't work without water. And I think it's extremely important as we just think about that. Look how that pot was shaped, but if I didn't have water, I wouldn't be able to make a pot. And I brought clay tonight, and I have these two pieces here. And externally, you can't really tell the difference, can you? One's bigger than the other, obviously, but, you know, from where you're at, they look pretty much the same, but you see, this one's soft and pliable, and this one's hard, like a rock. I can't do anything with it, although they look the same. They're both clay, they look the same, but one is not usable to the potter. I could put this on a wheel and begin spinning the wheel, and this piece of clay would just knock me around, and I could never get anything done. And you know, some of our hearts are like this with the Lord. They're hard. And he can't get through and he can't work. And as long as our heart is hard, he can't do what he needs to do in our lives or what he desires to do in our lives. Now, it's not hopeless for this piece of clay. You know, you look at it and you go, wow, so what happens? Well, all I have to do is put this in a bucket of water for a couple days, and then it's soft and pliable, and I can make something out of it. So even if your heart is hard, there's hope, and that's part of the main message tonight is the hope that we have in Jesus Christ. But if you stay like this, nothing's ever going to change. So I always take this guy and I put him right up front here where you can watch him throughout the presentation and just kind of see what happens, because I think that's important to keep an eye on him and make sure, you know, and watch him, because, you know, sometimes we think it's cool to resist God. You know, the world tries to conform us into its image, and so we get this idea that the right thing to do or the cool thing to do is to resist God. But I want you to watch this one who's resisting God here. Nothing happens. As a matter of fact, he's going to be the most uncool thing on this stage. Well, maybe besides me, but, you know, he's not going to be. He's just going to stay the same. Nothing's going to happen in his life. And, you know, we need to be aware of that. I believe there's probably some in a crowd this size who are hard to the Word of God. They've never even committed their lives to Christ. And, you know, this would be a great time to do it, to get into that water and allow him to work in your life. Now, what we're going to do now is I'm going to do some different demonstrations as we think about clay and the potter, and I'm going to kind of mess up a lot of clay. By the way, before I went into the ministry, I did pottery for 15 years for a living in a small town in Arizona, Bisbee, Arizona. It used to be a mining camp, and then it turned into kind of an arts and crafts community, and my wife and I had a pottery studio, and we did that for 15 years, and then the Lord called me into the ministry, and you know, I didn't touch clay for 10 years. I got busy serving the Lord, and you know, one day my wife, she comes home, and she says, you know, we're going to do a women's retreat, and this year we're going to do it on Jeremiah 18, going down to the potter's house. And I said, well, that's a great topic. You know, I'm a potter. I said, that's good. And then she said, you're our Friday night guest speaker. Well, that sort of scared me, you know. I mean, I thought, wow, you know. I thought, the very first thing that really popped in my head was, I don't know what to wear to a women's retreat. I have no clue. And then it was... how do I do this? You know what? How do I do this thing? And my wife says, oh, come on. You've made thousands of pots. And I said, yeah, I have. And she says, and you've been teaching the Word. And I said, yeah, I have. And she says, why don't you put the two together? And I said, because that's scary. You know, I know how to make pots and I know how to teach the Word, but trying to combine this was scary. Well, you know, that's called stepping out in faith and trusting God. One of those stretching experiences. And, you know, through this tonight, I hope that some of you see maybe some areas where you need to be stretched. But we're going to begin here. What I like to begin with is the fact that the clay has to be centered to be able to really be worked on the wheel. You have to put it on there and spin the wheel and put some pressure on it and center it. And without centering, you'll never get a pot made, ever. And some who have taken ceramics out there, you know, it's a difficult process. It's the hardest thing to learn. It's the most boring thing to watch. It's one of those tedious things that nobody likes, and yet it's the very thing you need to successfully make a pot. When I was beginning pottery in high school, I knew the first time I touched clay, man, I just fell in love with it and wanted to do this. And I can remember trying to center, and you would try, and you'd get it almost centered, and you'd always tell the teacher, is that close enough? And they'd always say no, and you know, when you're 17, 18, 16, you know teachers lie. So when they say no, you go, sure, it's close enough. You know, you know everything at that age, right? And you say, well, what does he know, man? And so you just try to make a pot, and you get it so high, and bleh, it'd fall. Well, that was back in the 60s, and back then smoking was politically correct or more than it is today. And so as a kid, you would just, you know, when it would fall, you'd just put some little dents in it and fire it and take it home for an ashtray for mom. And you'd say, Mom, look what I made. And, you know, moms always love that, don't they? They always, oh, look what you made me. So, you know, you'd make these funky ashtrays. But what we're going to do is we're going to show you what happens when a pot's not centered, because, you see, our lives are supposed to be centered on Jesus Christ. And some of us, here's what we do. We go like that, and we go, well, that's good enough. You know, just enough of Jesus to go to heaven, but not enough to make him our Lord and not enough to serve him. And, you know, we seem to be kind of content. We say, well, isn't that good enough? Isn't that enough? Now, that's like the pottery student saying, isn't that close? And look at that thing is wobbling. And, you know, when I was in the military, I was apprenticing under a potter, and he asked me, he says, you know, why don't you come and help me teach at this little college down in Texas? And it was an art school, and he said, why don't you come and help me teach? And most of them were art students into the oils and watercolors and drawing, and they had to take a ceramics class. You know those classes you have to take? You're not into them. Well, they were there, and I was trying to teach them how to center, and they would get like this, and they'd go, is that good enough? I'd say, no, you'll never get a pot made. So I worked with him, and I said, now you guys work on this week. You work, and I'll come back next week, and we'll go another step. And I came back the next week, and they hadn't touched clay all week long. I couldn't believe it. So I start yelling at him. I was passionate about pottery. I was very passionate about it, and they weren't. And so I start yelling at him, and the guy says, you know what, Pat? He says, I don't think you need to come back anymore. He says, you're not a teacher. And then it was really funny when God called me to teach, you know, his word. I thought, wait a minute, this never worked before. But anyway, here we have this thing. So many of us do this with our walk with the Lord. We say, well, that's close enough. Watch what happens to this pot. It's interesting. As we start here, we'll try and get it opened. Now, we get it this far, and some of you may say, well, that's not too bad, man. When I was taking ceramics, that's about what mine looked like. And, you know, now here's the really bad thing is, you see, Satan's right there to whisper to us. And he's there to tell us, hey, it's okay. You know, you don't really need to get serious about Jesus. Look, you're better than that guy. You know, you're kind of better off, and something's happening in your life. And he's there. He is faithful to lie to us, isn't he? And he'll tell us that. Now watch what happens. A little bit of pressure comes in our life, and, you know, we start going up, and now that's pretty funky, you know, as you're kind of going through life, and you're, and there's Satan lying to us still, saying, hey, that's good enough. It's okay. And so we go a little bit further, a few more, you know, maybe pressure, maybe the Lord trying to get us to step out, or something radical happens in our life, or some catastrophe, and we're going along, and man, you know, and our life is torn. We're shattered. We're calling friends, and we're calling the church office, and we're saying, man, I need some help. Look at my life. It's ripped. Well, your life is ripped because you're not centered on Jesus. You see, and I know what the pastors here would tell you. They would tell you, you got to get centered on Jesus. You'll get a pot like this every time, guaranteed, if you center it the way I did. And if your life is not centered on Jesus Christ, this is you. And tonight you know that. And so you have this. Now here's the thing. Some of you are going, man, that's me. Well, look, all I have to do is kind of mush it up here and work it a little bit. You know, and this is a little painful, but, you know, you work on it a little bit. But then I take this clay, and I can make a usable vessel. You see, I can make something good out of it. Now, we're going to set this aside. We're not going to do that tonight. And we're going to put him up here, and we'll just put a little face on him and kind of a straight face here. And we'll put him right here. So now you have this guy over here, remember? He hasn't changed. And you have this guy here. He's kind of bummed out, but, you know, there's hope, though. You got to understand there's hope. So now what we're going to do is we're going to make another one. And this one, what we're going to do is we're going to hopefully get it centered. I always use that word hopefully because you never know. So we'll work here. We'll get this one centered. Now, again, this is that major, major step that everybody wants to skip. And I think a lot of us in our Christianity, you know, it's just tough. So we got this guy centered. Now I'm going to open him up. And, you know, I think a lot of us do this with the Lord. Maybe we make that commitment. We're at church or whatever happens. We make a commitment. We grow for a while. And, you know, things seem to be doing well. And then, man, we get busy. We get really too busy to really be having that quiet time and that devotional time. We're not picking up our Bibles during the week. You know, we say in our hearts, oh, Pastor Chuck, you know, he'll read the Bible to us. He'll teach us. We'll eventually get through the whole thing. And you attend here and you just wait. Well, listen, I'm going to make this pot without water then. And I want to show you what happens, because you see, that's the thing that refreshes our souls. That's the thing that keeps us going, is the water of the Word. And so this is hard for me to do, because I always want to dip my hands in the water out of habit. So what we'll do is we'll start there, and again, that's the life, and you're thinking, man, I'm just too busy, and I don't have time to be in the Word. So again, some pressure, some stepping out, some work comes, and look, you're saying, man, hey, I haven't read the Word for a week, and I'm still doing okay. Things aren't too awful bad, and I'm surely like those losers, you know. I'm doing okay, and who's there to whisper to us? The enemy of our souls. He says, see, you don't need the Word, so you go a month, maybe 2 months. A little bit more pressure comes, and you see, you have that squeeze in your life, and you go up, and once again, it's not horrible. And the enemy's there saying, see, those guys that tell you you need to be in the Word, man, they don't know what they're talking about. And so maybe you go 6 months. You haven't had a quiet time, not a real quiet time. A little more pressure comes. And see, this one tears. And our life is torn. We're saying, why is my life this way? We haven't been in the Word in months. Now, here's the great thing about this. All you have to do is get some water. Work with the clay, begin to get that water in there, get the Word in there, and you can make a pot. You see, the choice is yours. You need to decide, man, you know what? Man, I see that. That doesn't work. You know, in our church, we encourage people to read through the Bible every year. I think that's important. I think as Christians, it's just like breathing air. We should be reading our Word. You know, it's life to us. So we'll take this guy, and this is a guy that, you know, he thought he didn't need the Word, and we'll put him up here next to this other guy, and he'll have a sad face, and we'll stick him right here, and you keep an eye on him. So we have these guys that we're watching here. Now, I think it's important that we understand we have the guy over there that's real hard, that you know, he's just resisting, and we have this one here that wasn't centered, and the guy there, but you need to realize still, again, all of those, all I have to do is work with them for a little bit, get some water in them or get them centered, and I can make a pot that's usable. It's not hopeless for them. And isn't that the great thing about Jesus Christ? It's never hopeless. But there's always hope in Jesus, and he's always there. You know, the potter and the clay. I would never tell that clay, hey, just go over there. I don't like you anymore. No, I want to work with it. Especially when I was doing this for a living, man, you get hungry. And you're thinking, man, I like that clay, you know. Come back here, and you'll work with it. And you know, the hungrier you are, the kind of skimpier you are with the clay, because you're not going to waste any. And you'll take that, and you'll say, man, I'm not leaving you there. So remember that with Jesus. There's always hope. Always hope. Now, this next guy, this is the hardest one I do, especially for people in the front row. This is the one, this one scares me. This is the one, can any of you relate to being impatient? No way, huh? You know, in our society, I don't know about you guys, but I think like microwaves are really slow now. You know, when they first came out, they seemed so fast. And now they seem so slow, you know, a minute to boil water, I can't believe that. Well, I think a lot of us are like that in the Lord. So we have, you know, we have this guy here who's just, come on, Lord, I can't wait for you. We got to hurry up and do this. We got to hurry up and do that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to demonstrate the guy that's wanting to get ahead of the Lord. And this one is scary because I'm going to speed the wheel up. Now, did you notice when I made a pot, how slow and methodically the wheel turned? It didn't turn real fast, did it? I didn't notice that for a long time in teaching this, and I was at a church, and the pastor came up later, and he goes, man, the thing that I noticed is, man, that wheel just turned at a steady pace, and I'm one who always gets in a hurry, and I thought, oh, I got to add that. So, you know, This ministry is great. It just grows. Now, so this one is scary because it could fly anywhere. And, you know, I really debated doing it here because I really don't want to get it on the carpet. I did it at our church and now it's getting quiet, isn't it? I did it at our church, and if it flies out there, someone lay down and catch it, you know? So I don't think it'll go that far. I did this at our church and boom, it went out on the carpet. Luckily, I knew the pastor and it was okay, so. But let's see. Now, see, that's fast. And some of us are going, come on, Lord, come on, hurry up. Well, okay, that's what happened. I mean, you know, this one doesn't get far at all, does it? That should teach us all a lesson, shouldn't it? Be patient, man. Wait on the Lord. Don't try and get it. This is the one that is the quickest, and praise God it didn't go on the carpet. And we have him. So, you know, this guy, what we'll do is we're going to take him, and we'll put him. I always just kind of, like, tuck him back here because he needs to hide for a while. So we'll put him back there and leave him out of the way. Now, here's something that Pastor Chuck didn't realize when he asked me to come was when I got saved, I had my pottery studio, and that was in the early 80s in Arizona. There was no Christian radio. There was no Christian TV. There was no Calvary Chapel. And some people introduced me to Calvary Chapel. They said, man, you just got to hear a tape, and they gave me one of Pastor Chuck's tapes. Well, there was a tape lending library in Tucson, which was about 100 miles away. I started mailing tapes back and forth, and I went through the whole Bible with Pastor Chuck, sitting at my potter's wheel, making pots, and listening to Pastor Chuck. I didn't share that in Tucson. And, you know, here's the amazing thing. As I was sitting there making pots, you know what my dream was? I thought, you know, if I could ever just go hear that man live, I could die and go to heaven. I said, that's all I wanted to do, was just one time come to Calvary Chapel and hear him. That was my dream. I never, ever, ever thought that I would be pastoring a Calvary Chapel church. You know, I didn't even have the privilege of going to a Calvary Chapel until I went to the Calvary Chapel Bible College that at that time was in Twin Peaks, and the first Calvary Chapel I went to was on my way going to the Bible College. And then the Lord allowed me to plan a Calvary Chapel, allowed me to be involved, and then now, Pastor Chuck says, can you come and share this message at Calvary Chapel, Costa Mesa? You know, God will do more than we can ever imagine or dream if we'll trust him, if we'll step out in faith. And, you know, that's the message that I want us to understand. Allow him to work in our hearts. Allow him to begin to mold and shape us. Now, we're going to get to the making another pot and go through sort of each process and talk about it a little bit. These are going to be successful ones. Now you know why I make one in the beginning. You see, if I didn't make that first one, you guys would say, I don't think this guy can make pots. So you know, you always try and make that first one because you have this mess up here and you're thinking, man, but hey, once again, if you're one of these guys, there's hope. Now, I pre-centered this because that's not the fun part to watch, but you know, that's the part, man. There's intense pressure when you're centering clay, especially this much. And some of you have seen Michael Rozell, and he does a big one. That takes a lot of pressure. And you know, oftentimes we relate that coming to the Lord, and I think that's true. But I think all of us need that centering in our lives once in a while. We tend to drift, just like the children of Israel. We tend to go off over here or off over there. And we need that pressure where we're brought back into the center of God's will. So, you know, I centered this one, done that pressure. Oh, by the way, there's a process that you guys didn't see. You see, when I got here this afternoon, I was out on the cement out there beating the tar out of this clay. You see, you got to work it and get all the air bubbles out of it. You've got to kind of be rough on it. And, you know, sometimes the Lord has to do that to us, doesn't he? He's got to kind of, and we're going, man, that doesn't feel good. And the Lord's saying, you know what? But you need this in your life if you want to be the vessel that I've intended you to be. And we've got to trust him. You know, you've got to say, okay, Lord, I don't fully understand. I'm not really even sure of why, but I'm going to trust you. I'm going to trust you because I see you've made some pots here. You've worked in other people's lives, and you must want to work in my life, so I'm going to trust you right now to do that work. And now you get centered, and, you know, if the clay, the great thing, when I was making pottery for 15 years, well, longer than that, but for a living for 15 years, the clay never talked to me. Praise God, you know? How many of us whine to God? No, don't raise your hands. Don't do that. We're whining all the time. And, you know, I'm so glad the clay couldn't talk because, you know, at this point, the clay would have been, what are you doing? Why are you doing this? What are you doing? You tell the clay, wait and see. So now this process here, I put my fingers right down in the center of the clay, and I push pretty hard to get my hand all the way down in there. Now, how do you think that clay would feel? I believe if it could talk, it would be screaming right now. Stop it! Why are you doing that? You know, I look at this part as that time when the Lord, you know, he touches inside and he hits that spot in our lives, that tender place that nobody else knows, not even our spouses, not even our closest friends. Nobody knows that spot, and the Lord puts his finger right on it. And we say, Lord, that hurts. And he says, yes, I know it hurts, but it's necessary if you're going to be the vessel that I intend for you to be. And it's just like this clay, if it could talk. Why are you doing that? It's necessary. I cannot get a pot made unless I put my hand down in the middle of it. He can't do what he desires to do in your life until he touches those places. And you and I, even though we don't understand, we need to trust the potter. Trust him. The clay's got to trust me. The clay has no mind of its own. This is, you know, this clay is not sitting here thinking, well, maybe it's sort of thinking something it wants to be, but only I know what it's going to be. So I begin to work on it. Now I do this tugging part, you know, and I begin to pull on it and pull straight out. By the way, these are all the real basic processes, and you pull it out. Now, I call that, you know, the times the Lord stretches us some in faith, and he says, hey, Pat, I want you to do a women's retreat. Oh, man. You know, no offense, and I say this and some women I think get mad. No offense, ladies, but it's hard to teach a group of ladies. You know, just a group of ladies. It's fine for me for mixed, but you go and there's a group of ladies and it's scary. And I tell my wife, I said, well, what do I do? I don't know what to do. It's this group of ladies. And she says, just be nice. Now, I'm not sure what that implies, you know, as she says that. She says, just be nice. You'll be okay. Just be nice. Well, so you step out in faith and do that, and then, you know, you get to here, and so this stretching process, the Lord does something, and you step out in faith, and you go, oh, wow, that wasn't too bad. Look, man, I'm starting to come, like, something's happening in my life. This is a good thing. And you, here's where we go. Cool, God, I'm done. The Lord says, no, you're not. He says, you know, next I want you to do this, or, you know, Some kind of catastrophe hits. And there's pressure, and we all need pressure. You see, this clay, for it to begin to be formed, I've got to put even pressure from the outside and the inside, and I'm going to squeeze it, and watch, it's going to begin to grow and take shape as I do that. You see, it begins to really do something, and now it's growing. And I think the clay, if it could, it would be screaming, what are you doing? What's the matter with you? And then as it begins to grow and take some shape, I think it kind of goes, ooh, that's kind of nice, you know, this is good. And then maybe it would say, it's time to quit. How many of you would give me $10 for this? No one, huh? Oh, I got one over here, maybe half bid. I think that was a $5 bid or something, you know. This isn't an auction, you know. Why aren't you going to pay me for this? It's not finished, right? Come on. You guys are sitting there saying, come on, Pat, give me a break. You're not serious. Well, then let me ask you this question. Why do you want to stop there with Jesus? Why in your life do you say, God, that's far enough. I don't want to go any further. I'm done. Who knows when you're done? Jesus does. You see, the clay doesn't know when it's done. And if you think this isn't worth $10, then don't you stop with Jesus. You let him do what he wants to do in your life. Now, some of you are going, oh, man, this is getting serious. Well, you see, now a little bit more pressure comes. and I squeeze it again, and it's time for it to grow a little bit more, and I think the clay's going, well, man, I wonder what's going to happen. And, you know, as we look at this, it's still not something that's got a lot of shape, a lot of form to it. Now, I think at this point, the clay would be saying, what am I going to be? What am I going to be? Huh? What am I going to be? You know, if it could talk to me, what are you going to make out of me? Well, you know, when I sat down, I have an idea of what I'm going to make. I know in my mind. I don't just sit and throw the clay on there and arbitrarily start pushing it around and do things. No, I have in my mind exactly where I'm going with this clay. The clay doesn't know that, does it? I throw the clay on there and it's going, what's going on? Well, I'm going to mold and shape you into something I've got in my mind. You see, as God begins to work in your life, all of us, where are we going? What are we going to do? What's going to happen? This is what the Lord says, trust me. I know where I'm going. Are you sure, God? He says, yeah, I'm sure. I've made a lot of pots. You see, this pot said, Pat, are you sure you can handle that? Of course I can handle that. How do you know? The clay would say, how, Pat, how do I know? Well, I would say, you know, look around, man. I've made a lot of pots. I know what I'm doing. Oh, by the way, if I do go, oops, God never does that. Just so you know. You know, sometimes that's where the analogy breaks down, because a potter can make mistakes, you know, and I don't want you to think, I'm the one he went oops on, you know, and it's not, no, God never goes oops, you know, I don't want you to get that idea. So, you know, this clay thing, what's going to happen and what are you going to do now? You give me $10 for it now? No. Yeah, I got some people up here. You know, you can usually, if I beg long enough, somebody will do it. No, it's still not finished. I still need to work on it. Now, something I want us to think about with this clay. See that guy over there? Still over in the corner? You wouldn't give me anything for him, would you? No, you're saying, come on, man, that's just like a rock, man. It's just a thing over there. It's common material, isn't it? We can find this any place, right? It's not really valuable. You're saying, Pat, why would I pay you for that? It's not valuable. And you're looking at that and you're going, well, it's a little better, but I'm still not going to pay you. But what makes this clay valuable? My hands. My hands. You see, that's what changes it from that or that into this or this or this. What makes it valuable are these hands right here. Now you're going, what about the will? Well, watch the will. Let me turn this on. There it goes. What's going to change that clay? Nothing. You see, if I go stand over here and we go out to dinner right now and get something to eat, we come back, it's going to be exactly the same thing. It's never going to change until my hands touch it. And that's what's going to change it. You see, that's what gives it value, the potter working in it. The same in our lives. What changes us? What gives us that value? It's Jesus working in our lives. And you know what's crazy is sometimes we go, God, that's far enough. Why don't you like go, you know, go to the neighbor's house or something? And that's what you're going to be right there. And the Lord's saying, man, the plans that I have for you, you see, the thoughts that I have for you, let me mold and shape your life. And you know, as we begin to yield now, see, I think this clay, I think the clay is probably dizzy by now, and it's saying, man, would you do something, you know? And maybe some of us in our lives, we're what's going on with my Christianity? How come I'm just spinning my wheels? And my question to you would be, are you really trusting the potter? Are you putting your faith in him? Are you allowing him to move? Even, you know, those hurts and those pains that you're going through, those trials and those tribulations, you know, they're not for nothing. They're not just something that's happening by accident. You have an awesome God that's working in your life, and he's molding and shaping you into the exact image he wants you to be. But it hurts. It's all right. Pain is okay, because he wants to do a work in your life. So we do a little bit, you know, a little bit more pressure. This whole thing about pressure, you see, wait a minute, I thought this Christianity was a good life. Oh, it is a great life. But you see, the pressures come and things begin to happen, and you grow and you're going, wow, this is kind of okay. Hey, look, I'm getting tall. Hey, this isn't too bad. You see, and you learn to accept the pressures in your life. You learn to accept what Jesus wants to do in your life. Oh, does the clay understand it? I don't think so. Do we understand? I don't think so. But you learn to accept it. And you go, man, I'm doing all right here. This isn't bad. And the Lord says, yes, but I've got many more plans for you. We don't want to stop there. Now, here's what's crazy is sometimes some people, here's what they do. Come on, man, let's get it really tall. Let's keep going. And even in our lives with Jesus, let's go. Well, you see, I know when to stop. This can't get any taller. If I continue to put that pressure in there and keep squeezing it and trying to make it taller, it's going to rip and break. I know exactly when to stop. It's funny when you know, the potter knows. He knows what he's doing. And my wife sometimes would be in the studio and she'd go, watch it, Pat. I don't think it's going to make it. As a matter of fact, I was doing this presentation the other day and something happened and she went, uh-oh. You know, always that. And I said, it's okay. The potter knows what he's doing. You see, I know when to stop. If I keep going on this, I'm going to ruin it. And you know, Jesus knows exactly what you can take. He knows exactly what you can bear. And he's not going to give you more than you can bear. You need to trust him. Just like this clay, trust me, you need to put your faith in him and say, you know what, Lord, man, if that potter can do that with clay, then I know you can do that with my life. And I know you haven't forgotten me. I know you're dialed in. Hey, have you noticed something? Have you noticed whenever my hands are on the clay, have you noticed where my eyes are? They're glued to the clay, aren't they? Why? Well, because I'm being intimate with this clay, and I'm not going to take my eyes off of it when I'm working on it. I'm not about it. If I look over here, well, then my hands are going to go over there, and the clay's going to be, and it's going to be a mess. I'm going to focus on that clay. Do you know where Jesus' eyes are when he's working in your life? They're on you. They're glued to you. He's wanting to be intimate with you, and you need to trust him. So now let's do a little bit of shaping on this pot here and try and give it some form. Now, this time, what I'll do is I'll put a little bit more pressure on the inside than I will on the outside, and it'll begin to bulge a little bit. I know some people don't like the bulge, but, you know, think of it spiritually bulging, you know, and we'll bulge out a little bit. Now, see, it's starting to take on some shape. It's not just some straight pyramid-looking thing. It's, oh, wow. Now, the pot at first is going, why are you doing that? Do you know what you're doing? Yeah, I do. Are you sure? Yeah, I do. I know what I'm doing. I'm confident with what I'm doing. Okay, well, that wasn't too bad. Are you going to do it again? Yeah. A little bit more, and the pot's going, come on, man. Are you sure? Yeah, you need a little bit more, and we'll push it out here a little bit more. Now it's starting to get round, and, you know, maybe the pot's going, hey, this isn't half bad. Do it some more, and there we're at that point now. The potter says, I can't do it anymore. See, I know exactly what you can bear. Now we get to one of my favorite parts as we do this. You see, as I bring this up, we get to this part that I call this, you know, the one that's mature in the Lord, and that's not always just age. I'm going to trim a little bit of this off. It's not always just age that you're mature, but you see, it's mature in trusting him. See, you've gone through it, and you're saying, it's okay, I can trust Jesus. Now, I want you to notice something at the top of this, how as I touch this clay, look how sensitive it is to the potter's touch. Look at that. Is that amazing? Isn't that cool? See, that's how I want to be with Jesus. You see, I want it when he just touches me, just barely puts his finger on me, I want to respond. I don't want to be out there on the cement getting beat, you know, where he's trying to, and I spend a lot of time on the cement with Jesus, you know. He's just saying, Pat, you're not getting it. I want to be sensitive to his spirit. You see, when he barely puts his hand on me, when he barely touches me, that I would move and I would be obedient to what he says. Now the clay at this point might get a little freaked out because we're going to go upside down here, you know. We're going to go all the way to clay. Wait, stop. What are you doing? Don't do that. Oh. And then it comes around and goes, oh, wow, okay. Now, here's what's crazy. The clay's going to go, oh, that wasn't that bad, liar. You know, we kind of do that with the Lord. We're scared to death, and he's trying to work in us, and we're going, don't do that. And then we get on the other side, and we start telling other people, oh, it wasn't that bad. You know, what kind of ministry is that? Yes, it was bad. We should tell people, man, I was scared witless. but I came through it. You know, the times that the Lord does his greatest work, I think, is when we can't do it in the flesh. You know, when we get to that point and we can't, when you're starting to go upside down, and you go, man, what is... And then we get like this and we go, psh, that was great. And you get on the other side and you're going, that's wonderful. Now we come to the part that, you know, this has got to be probably the most painful part for the clay. You see, it gets formed this far, and I think at this point the clay's going, hey, this potter, you know, he's okay. And he picks up the stick. I'm going to jab this stick in the clay. It's going to hurt. It's sharp. Now, but I'm not going to go like this. No, I'm going to do it very methodically. And I'm going to put it in just the right place because, you see, some stuff needs to be trimmed away. And sometimes in our lives, he's got to do that. He's got to do that painful process, and it's no fun, but it's necessary. It's necessary to become what the potter wants you to become. And so here we go, and the clay could be screaming like, great, stop it, stop it. And then I say, but it's got to be done. And you go all the way down, and you get to there, and it, okay, man, I survived that one. We take this, and we pull it aside here, and get that over there. Now the clay's going, oh, whew. I said, wait a minute, a little bit more. No! You take a little bit more off. We got to get this off the bottom here. And as we clean this up, now maybe this pot's going, hey, that wasn't too bad. And, you know, the pot's going, check me out, man. Well, look what I've become, man. I was just a lump of clay, and now look at me, and I'm not like these guys. Look at those guys down there, and look at me. And we begin to do that, and we start this boasting thing, and we check me out spiritually, and maybe even telling other people. And as we begin to do that, you know what the Lord sees? Here's what the Lord sees. And you're going, what is that? And that's what he sees. Now watch, it's not hopeless. Watch what happens. You see, we take this and we stick it in here and we cut it. We trim that off and we take this off. Oh, by the way, this was all flesh. You know, that's our flesh. And the Lord says, this is what I had in mind. And, you know, you were kind of like boasting and doing some stuff on your own. And he begins that work. You see, he doesn't set us aside. He sets aside the flesh, you know, and he begins that work in our lives. And he, like, starts squeezing us a little bit. And then he pulls this part out. We get to this point, trim it up a little bit with our sponge there. And we get like this. And look, we got a cereal bowl. Now, some people are going, man, I like the vase. Did you ever try and eat Cocoa Puffs out of a vase? Doesn't work. Doesn't work, does it? You see, we got Cocoa Puff fans. You see, it doesn't ever work to try and eat out of a vase. You need a bowl. And the Lord's saying all the time, man, I wanted you to be a bowl. But you were trying to be something you were never intended to be. And he cuts away all that flesh and he goes, I got the bowl. I got the bowl. Now some people are going, but isn't a vase better? No. Vase is better if you want to hold flowers. But a pitcher's great if you want to pour water. A bowl's great if you want to eat something. A plate's good. A platter's great to serve on. You see? We need to trust the Lord and let him make us into what he wants us to be, not something we want to be. Early in my Christian life, I thought I was supposed to be this missionary up in the mountains of Mexico. I tried to drag my wife up there and say, come on, we're going to go live in the mountains. We're going to go live in this little village, and that's what we're going to do forever. And, you know, sometimes people would say, have you prayed about it? And I'd say, just a little bit, you know, but I already know what God wants to do. And you kind of get that attitude. And, you know, I can't believe what the Lord's done in my life since I became really obedient to him and not trying to fit into somebody else's mold that they thought I needed to be. Let him work in your life. You know, people sometimes will say, well, why don't you make this out of the clay? Well, because I'm going to make out of the clay what I see, not what you see. And you need to be people who, you're going to trust the Lord. Don't try to be something that you're not. And don't try to be something that someone else is trying to make you. You be what God wants you to be. And you know, if he wants you to be a cereal bowl, you be a really good cereal bowl. If he wants you to be a vase, you be a really good vase. But be what he wants you to be. Because whatever that is important in the body of Christ. We need all sorts of different pots. I need all sorts of different pots. Now, this is only part of the process. It's too bad we couldn't spend like 4 or 5 or 6 days together and go through everything. You see, I touched this clay 21 times from start to finish. You're seeing one part of it, and then you take it from here and you put it in the kiln and you fire it to 2,400 degrees. That's way hot. And it comes out. It's like these that we brought. We brought a few of our pieces to show you, and you know, that's what it comes out. Now, here's something. I signed the bottom of my pots. You know why I signed the bottom of my pots? Not so that I'll know I made them, but that you'll know I made them. I know my pots. You see, I've made thousands and thousands of pots, and I know every one of my pots. Why? I've touched it 21 times. I can go anywhere and find my pots. If people have my pots, as a matter of fact, I bought a vehicle there in our hometown, and I went in to write the guy a check, and my pottery was everywhere in his house. He had canister sets. He had dinnerware sets. He had casseroles. And I'm looking around. I'm going, man, this guy bought a lot of my pottery. And, you know, I kind of felt bad because I didn't remember him. You know, and I thought, man, he spent a lot of money. And then we're sitting there, and I said, hey, you know, I said, I know the guy that made that pottery. And he said, really? Who is he? I said, why? You just can't be too careful, right? So why do you want to know? He said, well, because I want some more. And I said, well, I made those pots. He says, wow, will you make me some more? And I said, I can't. I said, I'm just too busy. I can't make you anymore. We have this lady in our church. I love this story. We have this lady in our church. She's kind of hyper. She teaches jazzercise, and we do baptisms at her pool once in a while, and we went to her house, and there's one of my casseroles in her kitchen, and I said, man, I made that. And here's how she is. She's so wired. She's, you did not. I said, yeah, Becky, I did. And she goes, no, you didn't. I says, Becky, that's one of my pots. And she goes, it can't be. And I said, would you go pick it up? And here's what's on the bottom of that pot. And I told her how I would sign my pots. And she goes, it's one of your pots. I said, yeah, I know my pots. You see, and here's the cool thing, man. Jesus doesn't have to grab us by our ankles and turn us upside down. And are you one of mine? No. You see, he knows us intimately, doesn't he? Why? Because he's been intimate in our lives. He doesn't have to do that. He knows you by looking at you. He loves you. So, you know, we get to this point, and we fire him, and I brought this pot just in case you don't get one made. You can kind of show people, well, this was what it was supposed to look like, you know, and you set it there, and you look, and this pot's what's called greenware. It's just dry. It hasn't been fired yet. And so I bring it, and it's rather fragile. You have to handle it carefully. And so as a potter, I look at this pot. Now, you look at the pot, and you go, come on, man, slap some paint on that pot. Just put that stuff on there, whatever you know, people are always funny when they talk to you. Just put that, whatever that stuff you put on there, and you know, get it finished. Well, you know, the potter's got to check out the pot, doesn't he? And as I look at the pot, I say, you know, there's one more process. You see the 21 steps. I said, there's another process for this pot that it's got to go to before I can fire it. And you might be saying, what is that process? Well, here's what this pot needs. Now, why is that pot broken? Now, this is the most serious part of this message. You see, that pot's broken because it had a crack in it. And if I would have fired it with that crack, it would have been completely useless. You know in the Bible where it talks about the potter's field? Well, you see, the potter's field was a place when you unload your kiln and you have cracked pots and they're fired and that crack is fired in them. You can't ever use them again, ever. They're done. You can't use them for what you intended. You can't turn them back into clay. They're useless. And so the potters would throw them out in that field, and that field was useless. So what's the potter going to do? You see, as the potter examines the pot, you can't see it, but the potter can see it. And as the potter examines the pot, he says, you know what you need? You need breaking. We sang that tonight, didn't we? And the potter says, you need breaking. Why do I need breaking? Well, you need breaking so, you see, I can take this clay and look at this, man. I can take it and see, I can take the living water and I begin to pour it on this clay. And look, it'll just soak it up. And I pour a little bit more, and it soaks it up. And then in a few hours, you know what I have? Clay that I can make something out of. Why did I break that pot? Because it was essential to get what I needed out of it. You got to understand that. Some of our lives are right there tonight. I know in a room this big, some of us are there. We're dying on the inside. We're saying, Lord, I don't understand. Why am I broken? And Jesus says, you're broken because you need it. And now will you trust me? And I'll pour living water into your soul. And that healing will begin. And I'll do a work that you can't even imagine if you'll trust me. Brokenness is never fun. A potter will never, ever break a pot just for fun. He'll only break a pot because it needs it. And then he begins to do that. Can you trust the potter? Of course you can. You see, as I look around, you have this guy over here. He just needs a bunch of soaking, man. He just needs to get in a barrel of water and get soaked up. These guys here, they just need some wedging, and one needs the water, one needs centering. This one's doing good. Some of you tonight, you know, you got to look around. You're someplace up here. Someplace you're here. Hey, don't forget the guy back here. But you're someplace up here. All of us are. Now, you know, some people may not agree with me, but these guys here, they've been fired. You know, they kind of went through the kiln, and I think in the kiln, as you're turning the heat up, they're going, what are you doing? Well, it's necessary. And then they scream out, you're killing me. Yeah, that's the idea, because I want you to be what I want you to be. But you see, I look at these guys as glory. This is when we get into heaven. Why? Jesus is never finished with us till we get into heaven, is he? He's always working in our lives. So, you know, part of this, I don't think any of us are in glory. Now, some of you go, hey, buddy, I'm in glory right now, man. I'm there, dude. No, I don't mean like, you know, in the spirit. I mean totally in glory. This is when we get totally into glory, and we end up like that, and we get there, and we're going to look around, and we're going to go, wow. Look what God made you. Wow, look what God made you. And we're going to be excited. But we're someplace on this stage. Hey, maybe you're this bowl and you're going, it's good. Well, you know what? If you're the bowl and it's good, you need to be ministering to this person. And you need to be reaching out to him and saying, what can I do for you? And you know what? If you're broken tonight, man, please, please cry out to Jesus and you find somebody to pray with and you pray. And let him begin to pour that water in. Man, don't stay that way. There's no need. And you need to trust him. But Pat, it hurts so bad. I know it hurts bad. You see, I think I was there about a year ago. It hurts bad. But you have to trust the potter. I'm not saying you have to understand. Just have to trust him and let him pour that living water in your life. So tonight, before you go, would you do me a favor and figure out where you're at and begin to pray about that and begin to let the potter work in you? Trust him, and it's going to be such a wonderful journey and adventure. Let's stand up and pray. Father, I thank you so much. God, for the love that you have for us and for the hope that we have in Jesus Christ. And Lord, I lift up my brothers and sisters in this room tonight, and I pray that you would minister to their hearts. Some, Lord, are hard tonight. Even during the message, they just didn't really want to hear it. God, I know you're greater than our hearts. Grab those hardened hearts. Pour water into them. Some, weren't centered when they got here, and to right now they have that desire. They're crying out, center me, Jesus. Some just need to get back into the Word and into that quiet time. Others, God, they're broken. They're desperately hurting. Touch them, Jesus. Heal their soul. Heal their heart. Lord, for the impatient ones, God, just pull them back in. All of us, Lord, I know maybe some of us are all through this presentation at different times. God, minister to our hearts. And Lord, I pray in Jesus' name that we would learn to trust the potter. That we truly would put our lives into the hands of the potter. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Pray you will take me, mold me, use me.